Welcome, Pirate fans, to our third edition of Pirate Classics Pregame with our head football coach, Steve Mooshagian, and we're going to break down the 2017 game against Bakersfield College. Coach Moose, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great. Just excited to relive some great memories of games in the past.
All right. So this was the next to last Northern Conference game of the year. Bakersfield was having a good year. They're 7-1. I think we were 6-2 coming into this, but we were undefeated in conference. This is a chance to clinch the fourth straight Northern Conference title. How was the preparation for the week?
Well, I think the biggest thing that the guys needed to understand, and they knew it, was that anytime you play Bakersfield, it's a huge rival game. It's been, it's been that way ever since. I was hired in 2010, and we've played them consistently. Prior to that, they hadn't been playing them every year. Mm-hmm. And from 2010, Jeff Chudy, the Bakersfield coach, was my old college roommate. So we had some, unfinished business, so to speak. You know, there was that unheard of competition between us, and we just had some wild games. And you know, you think back just to go to the 2012 season when we beat them in the regular season, then they beat us in the playoffs and went on to win the state title. So that was – and I think the biggest thing that coming into this game is they had our former quarterback, who was from Bakersfield that played for us, Brandon Jones, that played for us in 2015. He was a quarterback in 2017. And so I think it was – that added a little fuel to the fire there for this game.
Well, we're talking about as a chance for us to clinch our fourth straight Northern Conference title. We come out firing early, take a 17-0 lead in the first half. You know, how does that make the offense and the defense feel when the offense is scoring, the defense is throwing a shutout at that point? Is there a chance that some of the players may take a back seat? Even it's early in the game, but we're up big. Was that part of maybe what the coaches were trying to figure out on the sidelines too, to keep everybody in the game?
Without a doubt, it's my biggest fear when we get up big early. I mean, we can think back over my career at Ventura that no lead is a safe lead either way, whether we're behind by 21 or ahead by 21. And I think, we were playing really good, and I think that we seemed in that game to make just a couple – mistakes that were costly mistakes, whether it was a penalty, whether it was a blown coverage or something like that, that allowed them to get back in the game. And then when your game's fairly close at halftime, anything's possible, and they made their adjustments and we made our adjustments, and then it was a pretty crazy second half, I remember too.
So they do cut the lead. We go into half up 7. We come out in the third, and they get the ball first and drive straight down the field and score. What was the talk maybe for the offense as we came out for our first drive in the second half?
Well, I think what we always said is, hey, we can only control, one side of the ball. We've got to do our job now. The game's – it's back 0-0 again. We need to pick it up. We started off strong, and then we've kind of laid an egg here and shot ourselves in the foot a couple times. I think we drove down and were in there a couple times going into score, and again stubbed our toes either with a penalty or something along that line that took points off the board, missed field goals, those kind of things. So I think we were it was a good wake-up call, just put it that way. When they tied it up, it was a wake-up call for our offense. And then they started clicking.
Yeah. Well, then we get out of the third quarter. We're still up with 11-11 remaining in the game. We're up 10. And it comes back to, there's still time on the clock, but we're up 2 scores. What's the mentality on that drive to get us up by, 17? What's the talk to the offense, like, we got to score one more time to make it a little harder? Like, how did that talk go?
Well, we always talk about putting our opponents away, and we have to, believe me, we have to talk about this every week, and the killer instinct and doing those things. And it seems like some weeks it works really well for us, and then some weeks we're battling and taking the game longer into the fourth quarter than it needs to be. And I think at this point in the game, I wanted to be aggressive. I felt mm-hmm. like the you know, the tables had turned. I felt like we had the momentum and that we needed to finish them off.
Yeah. So it goes down about a little over 3 minutes left. We're still up 10. It's 41-31. It's fourth and one. And, you know, what's going through your mind? We're lining up for a field goal. What's going through your mind on the next play call?
Well, I remember that distinctively. My thought was I was always going to think the negative thing first. Like, if we go for it and it gets blocked and run back for a touchdown, now we're only, you know, it's 41-38. Mm-hmm. Let's, you know, if we miss it, it won't be a big deal. If we miss the field goal, because they'll have to still drive 80 yards and there's enough time on the clock that I felt pretty good having a 10-point lead. And then I looked and Kyle DeGanzik, who's our special teams coach at that time, we looked at each other and I said, we'd worked on this fake field goal. And we had Trey Lambert in there who really was a former receiver who could run really well. I said, this is the time to do it. We both thought they'd never be expecting a fake field goal there because you're up by 10 and you go up by 13. That's a pretty good margin right there. And so we thought that if we did this fake field goal, maybe we'll just get the first down. We weren't even thinking about scoring a touchdown, just get the first down and extend the drive. So it was really a pretty easy call when it's all said and done, because it was fourth and one. But for some reason, they thought we were going to kick it. And I think Cooper Garcia was our kicker that year, who ended up being leading the state in field goals. So I think it was a pretty good decoy with him. He was pretty accurate. And thought that, hey, they're going to expect us to kick it. You know, we've kicked it every other time. We've never shown this fake field goal, and we did it. And I think that was about as excited as I'd been to see that success happen. It did.
Yeah, in my history here, you know, I've been here, this is my sixth year being part of the athletic department. I think that was one of the only times I've seen you do a trick play in person. We've probably run maybe a handful in 6 years. So does that go into like the other coaches as they prepare to play Ventura College and they go, well, Moose is pretty on it. He's going to stick to the plan. And then you throw that curveball at him. Does that change maybe possibly how they think the next year when they have to play us going, hey, we got to remember this might come up. Does that go into that?
I think so. And I think it makes your next, you know, opponents have to look at it too, especially that year. I think we had, we still had Cerritos left to play. And then I think we had, the first round of the playoffs that year. And, you know, anytime you do those things, I think we had been in the past with our trick plays, we'd always used them in the first half. Mm-hmm. We always used them early in games, but they were usually like a double pass or in a reverse pass, and they weren't special teams fakes, so to speak. I mean, we had a fake punt here and there, but you're right. You could probably count them on one hand. And I think this was probably the best scenario that late in the game in that situation. I just thought it worked out good. It was just one of those things you could very easily, if it didn't work, you know, off the fake, my thought was if we didn't work and he got stopped, they still had to drive, mm-hmm. you know, and the time was in our favor. So I thought it was a pretty safe call. I probably would have second guessed myself afterward. Like we all do, but I thought it was really the right thing to do. It was perfect timing, so to speak.
Well, and it comes out, it works. It puts the nail in the coffin. No matter what Bakersfield does, they end up driving down the field late for a gimme touchdown. And once the clock runs out, though, after that, I think they onside it. We get the ball back. The game's over. How is that feeling knowing that you've won another conference title? You're going to the state playoffs and not just the bowl game. You're going to the state playoff bowl game. How's that feeling for everybody, coaching staff, players, support staff? How's that feeling on the sidelines?
It's a great feeling. I mean, it's a great moment. It's one of those things that you get to, you get the 24-hour rule. You get to celebrate it. I always have a little bit of worry when we still have a regular season game to go, because I thought back of our 2014 season when we had beat Hancock and won the championship, and then we went down to we went to Bakersfield and lost, and we had like four or five players that were banged up that we chose to keep out of the game. And it was hard to keep our kids focused, but I knew we had another home game, so I didn't feel is worried, but it was Cerritos, and I know the rivalry there. So my joy, you know, lasted till my brain took over and said, don't get too far ahead of yourself. You got one more game to play. Yeah. You know, those kind of things. Those are head coaching things. You can't, you know, you're always going to have those things. But the players, to give them credit, they came back and played really hard the next week too. So that team was rolling at the time too. We had a pretty mature team. Jake Constantine had solidified himself as the quarterback, and we were pretty good, you know, on defense. We were pretty good on offense. We had everything going in the right way. I think we were a complete team by that point.
Yeah, well, like we talked about in our first episode, this first three games have been this 2017 season. You know, opening day was the young new team, kind of like, let's figure out what we're doing. Now we're in game nine. You know, Jake Constantine, you brought him up. He goes for 357 in the air. Duckett had another great game, 80 yards. You know, we were a little more balanced still. It wasn't like the year before we were all throw. But did this maturity, as the year went along, you go into this game for a championship, did that maturity of the year play a big part in this?
It did. I didn't have the worries that I did early on, because a lot of times we just had a lot of new players. We had some transfers, we had some red shirts, and we had to, you know, the chemistry had to all gel. And this team had gelled going into that game. I felt pretty good that if we just got off to a good start and stayed the course, that we were going to be a pretty good football team. I still believe had Jake Constantine not got hurt in that playoff game against Riverside, that we would have been playing Fullerton for the Southern California Championship that year. I really thought this team, the 17 team, was one of our most talented teams, and they were clicking on all cylinders at that time of the year. So I felt really good about where we were going.
Well, this was a good game to end our first three episodes of our Pirate Classics. Once again, thank you for coming on. To everybody out there, it'll be shown on Saturday night, 6 p.m. on the Crown Plaza VC Sports Network. And then next week, we'll start a new season of Classics. I think we're moving to 2018, and we got a lot of stories there. So hopefully everybody comes back on Friday nights at 6:15 p.m. on the Pirates YouTube channel to watch the pregame show. So, Coach Moose, thank you again for coming on. Can't wait to watch it in my backyard this weekend. I'll probably have the barbecue going again and have a good time on my iPad and enjoy the warm, warm weather.
That's definitely right. It's nothing better. And, you know, it's always great to look back and watch these guys play and then think that some of them are going to turn around and play, you know, again on Saturday during the day, or even Sunday, now that Jesse Lemonnier was activated for the Los Angeles Chargers. So it's exciting. It really is. And hopefully we'll have a few more good memories after this week as we go into 2018.
All right. Well, Coach Moose, thanks again for coming on. Fans out there, can't wait to see you guys in person. Hopefully it'll be sooner rather than later. But we'll see you guys on Friday night and Saturday for the game.
Thank you, and go Pirates.